Man, we out here talking about trees a lot, right?
Yes.
The question we usually get is about fertilizing trees. So what is the best way to fertilize trees?
There's a few different ways to fertilize trees. First, let's start off with the time of year, the pruning.
Yes.
Okay. I feel like it's best to fertilize in the beginning of fall.
Okay.
And also in the early spring. But let's go back to the late fall. You want to get your pruning out of the way. Go ahead. Okay. If you're going to prune the tree, do your pruning first. Like remove some of this growth that's coming off of it right here if you don't want it.
Okay.
Kind of thin the tree out just a tad just to get rid of some unnecessary growth or dead branches. And then come in and let's do some fertilizing.
Gotcha.
Take a look at this root system that we have here.
It's pretty impressive.
I mean, we can actually see these roots. There's a reason for that. Some of these roots are growing in a girdled fashion that might be due to the excessive mulch that has been used over the years.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to guess this tree to be about 10, 12 years old, roundabout.
Okay.
This tree needs deep root injection. You could do a granular, just spread it out over the ground. That's not going to go very deep. It's probably going to end up down here for the grass.
Yeah.
You could do a drill hole method where you could take and drill holes in it, just get a long auger bit, and you might get caught up in some roots. So that's not necessarily the best way, but it works.
Okay.
You know, just drill some holes and poison compost or some good organic material, organic fertilizers down in there.
So we use the organic material though. That's something we rake, you know?
You can rake.
Over those holes?
You can pour it in there depending on what type of mixture you're using. Is it going to be in the powder form? Is it going to be in a liquid form? Or is it going to be like in a dirt form?
Yeah. Okay.
On large trees, we've done vertical mulching where we've used an actual auger like what you use to put in fence posts.
Okay.
In vertical mulching, we drill these holes about every 3 feet apart to create some airspace, and then we backfilled with some organic compost.
Okay.
Or sometimes you can put rocks in there just to create the larger airspace.
Okay. And the roots are going to move into
the roots,
that space, right?
That's what you want them to do.
Gotcha.
They don't always
Makes
do
sense.
That. So my best practice for deep root fertilizing is to inject the soil with a liquid fertilizer that you inject into the soil at a PSI of about 125 to 150. You can even go up to 200. I know people that go up to 200.
Okay.
So think about this. As you're injecting that nutrient fertilizer, the organic fertilizer into the soil, you're going to want to use a slow release too. I'll explain that in just a minute.
Okay.
But as that PSI, the 150 PSI, goes into the ground and it pushes that soil out. It creates an air, water, nutrient space. Ah. So it creates space in there. So like with this soil right here, take a look at these roots. They're growing right on top of the ground.
Yes, they are. Yes.
You're not gonna find very many of these roots down low, I promise you. This soil is not, it's good for willow trees and stuff that we have growing around us. Those are wet bottomland type trees. This is a maple. It's a bottomland tree too, but it's planted in a manicured landscape.
Right.
So with that injection, you're going down 6 to 10 inches down, and you're injecting fertilizer, airspace. You're going to start promoting this tree to go to where that water and nutrient space is.
Gotcha.
So the roots are lazy. In this case, they're staying on top of the ground.
Yeah.
They're growing down the hill. They're getting mowed over.
Yes.
So now as this tree grows, you're creating that space, and it may take several years for this to happen. But you're going to get a root system that's going to be down, and you're going to mitigate the soil with your organic fertilizer and other products that you can inject in here. Let's say, for example, you put the fertilizer in the soil and your pH is off. So that creates that buffering capacity to where even with the nutrients in the ground, the water's in the ground, that buffering capacity prevents that tree from being able to absorb it through its small feeder roots.
Okay.
The feeder roots are like hair roots. They're real small, like our hair. So you want to add something to the soil that's going to change that pH. Usually it's going to be lime that you want to add to it. Okay, that takes a little bit of time for a tree to change that pH, but you just have to do it. Something else to add to your mixture of fertilizer is mycorrhiza, a mycorrhiza inoculant. And you can get it in either an ecto or XO type mycorrhiza formula. In this area, we're going to have Amanita, rosapogon, different ones like that. There's different species of those two right there.
Okay. Okay.
But what that mycorrhiza does when you inoculate your soil with it, it actually works symbiotically with the feeder roots. It grows, and its mycelium grows, and it attaches itself to the feeder roots of the tree, and now it's feeding off the protein of the roots. When it sheds its, basically its scale or its bark off, it feeds on the proteins produced by those roots, and in turn, it works as a sponge, and it pulls the water, the nutrients into the tree, where typically, before the mycorrhiza was there, it wasn't available to it.
Okay.
So they kind of work together.
Right.
And research shows that trees that have been inoculated with that mycorrhiza are much healthier than a tree that hasn't been inoculated with it. So it's very beneficial.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, mycorrhiza.
That's good. Let me ask you about this again, because you mentioned it. So one more time, I usually get a lot of questions about, so I have my roots above the ground.
Mm-hmm.
How can I encourage those roots to get back down in the ground? Will they go back down into the ground?
Not typically. That's a very good question.
Like this,
so
yeah.
What we want to do with that point, since you've mentioned that, that's a very, very good, good subject right there. You want to get down and close with the tree and pull this back. This is going to require a tool.
Yeah.
And these roots that you see right here,
follow
it back to where it originated. So that root might have come from this side of the tree.
Yeah, it looks like
it did. So eventually, as this tree is growing, it's not growing vertically with the tree like those. It's growing across the tree. So over time, as this girth grows here, it's going to attach to here because this root's going to grow too.
Gotcha.
And it's going to end up girdling this side of the tree. Mm. It may graft into it being a maple tree, or it may not. It may just cut the circulation off right here. So after you trace that root back, wait until the winter time when all the leaves are falling, all the nutrients are dropped back down into the root system for storage. You might want to cut that root off.
Wow, okay.
And don't use an axe, don't use a chainsaw. Find out where it's at and try to use some hand tools so you don't cause damage to other parts.
Okay, gotcha.
And then you come back over here to this other side and work on these roots that are closer to the trunk on this side, because you see now, we got two sides of the tree that are potentially going to be girdled. Cut these off over here. And you don't want to go crazy just cutting all the roots off, but you're going to have to at some point.
Right.
For the tree's health.
Right. But the tree will still be okay. Because I'm sure people are listening to you like, okay, you're going to
just cut the roots.
You just cut roots.
Well, you can cut the branches out of the tree. Why can't you cut a few roots?
All right. There you go. Okay.
You know, I mean, the roots serve a distinct purpose. You know, conduction, storage, anchorage. So you want to be cautious on which ones you cut off.
Okay.
It's best to ask a certified arborist, somebody that knows and that's familiar. Not every certified arborist is familiar with root pruning, but most of them are.
Right.
And
well, that's why we ask you, Wes. Yeah, that's why we ask you.
Ask me.
That's
just call me. I love the questions. I love to share my information.
Oh, we know. We appreciate that.
I do. But once you get where you feel like you're comfortable, you're not taking off too much. It'd be like me going to getting a haircut and they cut off too much. I'm not going to like it.
Yeah.
The tree will tell you it won't like it either.
Right.
But you get out here and you see these growing on top of the ground.
Yeah.
Let's use another example. Imagine this is at your grandmother's house and your grandmother walks on a cane or a walker and she can't go out into the yard because you got all these roots. Yeah. So just after you start promoting the root growth down low, think about either adding just a small layer of sod or some topsoil and maybe some sod on top of it. That way you're hiding the roots. Now I've done this before with a maple tree. This maple tree had literally taken over the front yard. So we can do some root pruning on it. And I was in discussion with the landscaper on this. And while we're looking at all these roots on top of the ground, and I look at the neighbor's yard next door and I said, got an idea, guys. We're going to not worry about cutting all these roots. We're going to add and smooth this out with a little topsoil or organic good soil. And then we're going to put sod on top of it. And then we're going to be done with it.
Wow.
So that was the easiest solution.
So that doesn't smother the roots?
If you put too much of dirt on top of it, you're going to change your water flow and everything else. So be cautious. Once you get over, let's say, 4 inches of fill, you're going to start cutting off some of the air flow or the oxygen supply that gets down deep. But that's where that deep root injection comes from, because you're creating new space down there for your air water nutrient.
Wow.
And do that on an annual basis. Just include that in on your tree budget.
Okay. Put it in on your budget. Yep. And one more time before we have to leave. So the best time to fertilize is?
Late fall or early spring.
Late fall, early spring. Thank you, Wes. Appreciate the knowledge as always.
Thank you.
Thanks for watching the video. I hope you enjoyed it. To find out more information on this topic, just click on the familyplotgarden.com link in the description.